I'm Richard Vobes, and I'm on the trail of the old smugglers on the south coast of England.
Just who were they, and what were they up to? This time, I'm on my bike, exploring the most notorious area for free trading. I'm investigating secret passages and learning about the ancient laws of the Cinque Ports.
I'm also going to try and smuggle this illicit tea and sell it on the black market. Join me for another episode of The Bald Explorer. Today, I've come to the Romney Marshes for my investigation. I'm in search of smugglers of the 18th and 19th century, and before. This whole area, an incredibly flat area down on the south coast of Kent. It's an unusual area because it used to be underwater. The sea receded, it became a marshy bog. It has been drained by a series of dikes that crisscross the marshes and now have taken the water away and made it incredibly fertile.
This area is known as the Invasion Coast and lies just 70 miles southeast from London. The Romney Marshes are incredibly flat and has been an ever-changing landscape with the sea slowly receding over time. Russell Thorndike set his Dr. Sin stories here, and Rudyard Kipling based his famous poem about the mysterious goings-on in the area. If you wake at midnight and hear a horse's feet, don't go drawing back the blind or looking in the street. Them that ask no questions isn't told a lie. Watch the wall, my darling, while the gentlemen go by. 25 ponies trotting through the dark, brandy for the parson, baccy for the clerk, laces for a lady, letters for a spy. Watch the wall, my darling, while the gentlemen go by.
I know it doesn't look like it now, but actually these marshes, the Romney Marshes, and this whole area was incredibly renowned for smuggling. And that's why I've come here to investigate. Brilliant.
Britain is an island and lends itself to the honourable tradition of free trading. Most parts of the coast have had its fair share of illegal imports and exports. Brandy for the parson, baccy for the clerk. None more so than down on the Romney Marshes, home of the 25 ponies trotting through the night. But I'm not looking at the wall, my darling, as the gentlemen go by. No, not a bit of it. I'm out to investigate the people who lived here, the unique landscape that they inhabited, and why they needed to turn to smuggling in the first place. Today, the Romney Marshes is home not just to intensive farming, but a series of picturesque towns and villages. Rye, for example, used to be a major port, but the sea has receded, leaving it literally high and dry. It has a trapped-in-time quality. Lydd is another such town, in fact the most southerly one in Kent, and built upon the first sandy island to form as the bay evolved. Isolated like so many of the communities, its parish church looms large and can be seen for miles around, and is known locally as the Cathedral of the Marsh.
This old church wall here is all that's left of a community that once stood here. And the Romney Marshes are littered with the remnants of vanished villages. It's hard to believe that this area was an island on the old River Rother, which has now since moved west. The River Rother actually ran along here. It's since silted up and moved over, and you had the original port of Old Romney back up that way, which now just has not much more than a church and a few houses. You've got New Romney that way on these three islands, and the middle island, which was Middley in the middle island, and obviously had a community, quite a small community, but they had an amazing church, and you can picture it in its day. This wonderful church must have looked fantastic. Times were hard in the Middle Ages, what with famine, lack of work, storms, plague, malaria. It's no wonder they up sticks and moved off. But places like this were absolutely perfect for the smugglers. You could hide your contraband quite easily here, and the preventative men wouldn't find it.
I wanted to learn more about the smuggling activities in the Rye area, so went to see local museum chairman Joe Kirkham. Firstly though, could she tell me more about the unusual museum building?
Wipers Tower or Baddings Tower or Rye Castle.
And where does that come from?
Well, Rye Castle was what it was built at for the king, and then there was somebody called Baddings who lived here, and then somebody called Wipers who lived here. It was defence against the French because the French kept raiding.
Right.
And then when things quietened down a little bit, they let it out to be a home, but always could be used for defence if necessary. And then eventually it became the prison as well as defence.
Gosh.
And it became the courthouse as well as the prison. And it's gone on all the way through when it was the prison until the end of the 19th century. This is a smuggler's lantern. They would have put an oil lamp inside here. This comes off. Homemade, I would have thought, by the local blacksmith.
Right.
And the lamp would have gone out through the pipe,
yeah,
and you would have signalled out to sea and said, whatever the signal was, that it was ready to come in, or please don't come in with your boat.
And the idea of that is so that anywhere else you can't see the light.
That's right, that's right. Because, of course, it was meant to be total darkness.
Yes.
I don't know when these, there's no date on them, but we think these were developed from about the 1600s.
Right.
This is probably about 18.
Yes.
I mean, Rye was the capital of smuggling for many centuries. It started off in the early 1200s, and I'm afraid to say it's still going on.
What kind of things were there to prevent the smugglers from unloading their cargo?
At the beginning, very little. I mean, because everybody was involved and it gave them an extra bit of income. I mean, it was very low wages here, you know, the sheep rearing on the marsh for the ordinary labouring folk.
Yes.
And of course, the upper classes quite liked their brandy and so on as well. But then gradually they decided after the Napoleonic Wars they'd really got to put their foot down and stop it.
Yes.
And this is when you started to get the proper coast guards then. And the coast guards became much more organised, even though they were outnumbered 50 to 100 to 1. And very dangerous job, and there were quite a lot of deaths. These are really clever advice. The riding officer would be on his horse and obviously couldn't carry very much.
Yeah.
But these, any of the barrels of cognac and some that was brought in was very highly concentrated. And so when a barrel was acquired, they would put these balls into it and it told them what proof it was. Depending on how many floated, that was the proof.
And Dr. Wilson is the guy who
came up with
the idea.
He's the guy who designed it, yes. I wish I knew a bit more about it. But of course everybody was involved. You either had the dress that you knew who were involved, the ladies would hide things under their skirts. You got the furniture that had false bottoms in drawers and that sort of thing. The rooms would have swivel cupboards so that you could get down stairs somewhere else. All the attics, for example, on Lion Street ran into one. You could get into one and run down the whole street.
Gosh.
So all sorts of things, things on floats that would be under the water, things that would be on the water. They got all kinds of things.
Know that the price of petrol and diesel is extortionate, but we also know it's not really the cost of the fuel that's expensive, it's the tax they stick on it.
But tax is a necessary evil. Without it, we wouldn't have emergency services, national security, or schools. Our streets wouldn't be lit, the bins wouldn't get collected, and to be honest, the roads, well, they'd be in a horrible state. I know we all like to moan about it, but I think we do agree that a small amount of our wages does have to go to the man in the ministry so that we can enjoy a civilised world. But tilt the balance a bit, make that mandatory payment a little more on the steep side, and your population are going to have more than a bit of a moan. Squeeze the hard-working poor and the not quite contented with their lot middle classes too much, and they're not just going to have a grumble, they will revolt.
There was a time, though, when the monarch desperately needed some cash to fund the wars they'd set their hearts on. The English kings loved nothing better than to nip over to France, have a bit of a punch-up, set fire to a few villages, and stick two fingers up at the French, jeering that our archers were better than theirs.
Which is all very jolly, but someone's got to pay for it.
Richard II had learned his lesson back in 1381, when Wat Tyler and quite a few of his mates went on the rampage, hacking off the heads of bishops and the idle rich, burning the houses of judges, lawyers and anyone who looked toffee-nose and had a plummy voice, during a non-official protest which we now call the Peasants' Revolt. He worked out that taxing the poor too much was not always a good idea.
Edward I had a brainwave. He realised that England's number one most desired and sought after commodity was wool.
Yes, our sheep. Those lovely cuddly bundles of candy floss on legs, meandering up and down the hills and the open spaces. They, well at least their fleeces, could fund his army and pay for the invasions on the continent and all the flag waving.
So how's he going to do that? Easy. And the great thing is, this isn't going to cost those ungrateful, griping peasants a single penny. He would stick a tax on all the wool that was exported overseas. Let the cloth manufacturers from Flanders and such places cough up the dough he needs for his war games. And not only that, in order to help his government collect these lovely pounds, shillings and pence, they would only be able to export this wool from a limited number of ports. It was called the wool staple. So there we go. That's fair, isn't it? Now everyone's happy. Well, apart from perhaps the foreign merchants who have to pay a little bit more for everything. But who cares about them? It's not like they can get their wool from anywhere else, is it? Or could they?
Well, we'll come to that in a moment. But first, was this new scheme quite as fair as it sounds?
Well, no. Not if you're a sheep farmer miles away from the nearest staple town or wool port. See, whereas before you could quite simply just load your wool onto a cart, take it down to Fred and his dinghy, and he'd sail across the channel and flog it to the highest bidder. Well, now you've got to load up a score of pack horses, go marching off potentially hundreds of miles across dangerous road conditions, open to the elements, vulnerable to thieves and bandits, wasting your own time and money to get to the correct export point, and then you pay a tidy sum to the Crown for the privilege. Charming.
So is it any wonder if somebody leaps out at the shadows at you and says, "Oi, I can shift your stock for you and get a pretty penny, no questions asked," that you're sorely tempted to break the law and risk the consequences, which, for a short while, included the death penalty.
But who's ever going to find out? Especially if it was in the middle of the night, on a remote bay, in the middle of nowhere, with no street lights, customs men, nosy parkers asking, "What are you doing with all those packs of wool you're loading into that boat just off the shore?" And so it was, the smuggling era began. Although, to be honest, they weren't really known as smugglers back then. Those ghostly figures in the 14th century crunching around the pebbly beaches of Britain in the dead of the night were known as owlers. And that's how they used to communicate. Just a minute. Hold on a tick. Just a minute. You're not a real smuggler, are you?
I am a real smuggler. I've been coming down here for years on the boats and getting all the old stuff coming in. Hello?
Oh, Daphne, dear. Yes, hello. Yes, how lovely to hear you. Yes, I'm still on the set at the moment in time, yes. Yes, I shouldn't be too much longer. Yes, there may well be a second series.
Well, the idea of having an export tax on merchandise leaving the country was brilliant. But the King and his advisers wondered, could it be improved?
Well, yes, it can. Why not do the reverse? Why not add a duty to the goods coming in as well as going out? Oh, what a clever idea! What geniuses we all are! This is quite a unique part of Britain, and was one of the busiest spots for outrageous lawlessness. And what made it perfect for the medieval smugglers was its close proximity with France. Just look at the map, and you can see the English Channel, see how narrow it is. I mean, you could almost walk across to France with one tiny step. And of course, if we could do that, so could anyone with a particularly nasty mean streak do the same coming the other way. Well, just like the Romans did in AD 43, or the Normans in 1066.
So sometime in the 12th century, and we don't know precisely when, five ports were given special status. They were known as the Cinque Ports. Not sink, as in every time you bring a boat to harbour, it drops to the bottom like a stone. No, cinque, as in the French for five, five being the number of ports, and ports being where the boats are for the king, armed to the teeth, who counted on them for the defence of the realm. You see, the Confederation of Cinque Ports and two ancient towns, to give them their official title, were basically Hastings, Romney, Hythe, Dover, and Sandwich, with Rye, where we are today, and Winchelsea added later. They were given the special task of providing the king with his sort of first ever navy. He required 57 boats, with 21 sailors on board for 15 days of the year. He wanted them ready so that they could prevent an enemy force from invading the country, or to attack an enemy foe in the English Channel, or to ferry the monarch and his entourage of hangers-on to and fro from Calais so he can visit his domains overseas. A sort of an elaborate taxi service.
Which might all seem a bit of a kerfuffle and a drag on resources when you're trying to earn a living on a fishing community stuck on a waterlogged marshland like this. But the privileges in exchange for this special service made it very lucrative indeed.
For a start, the people of the Cinque Ports were exempt from tax. Result. They had the right to self-govern. They could set their own tolls. They could punish or even execute criminals. They could lock up those that broke the peace and caused minor offences. But better than that, they could claim lost or unrecovered goods such as wrecks or stranded ships that limped onto their beaches. Oh yes, the arrangement paid handsomely.
So in a nutshell, the Cinque Ports and the villages within the Romney Marshes became their own little province. Provided they supply the king with his ships and men for his navy, they could virtually do whatever they liked.
This is a very peculiar peninsula, shingle bay and vast. This shingled beach has changed quite dramatically, particularly over the years when some of the smuggling gangs were working here. It's actually hard to believe that this is reclaimed land. The bit I'm walking on now, a few hundred years ago, would have been under the sea. I'd be swimming now. In the 18th century, large organised gangs operated here. Gangs like the Hawkhurst gang. Now, they were a phenomenal gang. It's rumoured that they could summon up 500 men and horses within an hour. They would unload their cargo and get it away in the dead of the night. And on here, on Dungeness and through the Romney Marshes, it's really not hard to believe that. Gangs like the Hawkhurst gang would also organise the delivery of the illicit goods up to London and the mysterious men who put up the cash for such activities. The locals were encouraged to help and assist the smugglers, and they were paid handsomely for their assistance. I mean, when you consider that the average farm labourer would earn perhaps 7 or 8 shillings a week, and that's a 6-day week, mind, from dawn till dusk, hard graft, and yet one night of humping a few tubs and hiding them in secret hidey holes, they could earn maybe 10 of those lovely shiny shillings. You can see why they were quite willing to get involved and, more importantly, would keep their mouths shut. So wool was being smuggled out of the country, and now luxury goods were being smuggled into the country. Quite a business. I think I need a drink.
I mentioned the Hawkhurst gang just now, and I'm going to do so again. The Hawkhurst gang, which, funnily enough, came from Hawkhurst, this small village slap in the middle of the route between London and the Romney Marshes. It wasn't the first, but it was probably the largest gang, and towards the end of its reign in the mid-18th century, the most violent of smuggling gangs in all of Britain.
And this rather charming, innocent-looking family pub was its headquarters. So, I can't persuade you to buy any of my illicit tea, then?
No, thank you.
No. Oh, right, OK.
Thanks very much. Well, that's Paul. He's the current landlord of the Oak and Ivy. He may look rough and ready, but he isn't actually a smuggler. In fact, he's not old enough to have been around during the Hawkhurst gang's reign of supremacy back in the 1740s. But he does know that this beautiful old pub originated in 1411. Well, that's pretty old and most likely to have been a yeoman's house and probably a fairly well-off one, because you would have needed quite a lot of money to afford a pucker timber frame building such as this back then. Of course, it was much smaller in its day, just this side of the building, complete with a thatched roof and wattle and daub for walls. But look at these amazing beams, all original. The fireplace was a later addition, and look at the size of it, it's magnificent. It actually dates from the 16th century when the original house was extended. So it's not too far from when it would have been full of blokes in here with big biceps and the tubs secretly pushed under the table and a thirst for the finer things in life. So instead of a pint of ale, maybe I should have a glass of Napoleon's finest. Oh! 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 I don't think that's been let down. That's 70% proof!
Actually, that was a nifty trick the smugglers would do. Because the regular barrels of legitimate spirits were transported in containers far too big and heavy to manoeuvre covertly, smaller tubs were specially designed either to be slung over the neck and carried in pairs or hung over a pack horse very neatly. They filled them with the desired tipple at a much higher alcoholic proof than normal, typically around 70%, before being shipped over. It was watered down later, once safely delivered. Clever, eh?
So the great advantage of a pub like the Oak and Ivy was that it was tucked away from the main village, but still on the route through Kent up to London, from where the contraband would have been ordered.
There were two types of smugglers, the land smugglers and the sea ones. The sea variety, they were the ones that actually brought the luxury goods over to this country, stashed away secretly on board their vessels. At the designated time, the sea smugglers brought their blacked-out sailing crafts and landing boats to the various shores and watery inlets and waited. It was the land smugglers that then emerged from the undergrowth, crept up and unloaded the haul, carried it inland and arranged delivery to the money men. Quite an operation, and many of them planned and arranged from the Oak and Ivy.
Back on the Romney Marshes, and I'm still lumbered with this bag of illicit tea. You might ask yourselves, why tea? Surely that's as cheap as chips. But in the 1740s, tea was one of the chief goods smuggled in. It could be bought in Holland for about sixpence a pound and then sold on the black market for about 3 or 4 shillings a pound. Now that's a massive markup and still be a shilling cheaper than the legal price of tea with the proper duties imposed. I suppose if I get desperate, I could always have a bit of a brew up. Actually, that's quite interesting, because in England at that time, we were drinking more than three times the amount of tea that was legally imported. And I don't need to tell you where the rest was coming from, do I? So, do you fancy a bag of the stuff, then? So how did the smugglers get away with it for so long? And what were the authorities doing to prevent these activities? After all, the Crown must have been losing shedloads of lost revenue. They must have been going nuts to stop these criminals. The truth is, not really. You see these charming cottages? Before the Coast Guard were watching out for people in trouble at sea, they were guarding the sea for completely different purposes. These are the homes of the preventative men. Prevention at first was actually quite lackadaisical. Yes, you had the customs men down at the harbour checking over the boats and making sure that everything was pukka. And if they did find something, well, obviously they confiscated it and locked it up in a warehouse. But that didn't faze the smugglers at all, because they would just come back at night, bash the night watchman over the head and make off with their goods. But very often they didn't have to resort to violence to get their illicit goods. Bribery was rife, and by far the easiest option. But not all illegal goods were coming into the harbours and ports, far from it. But how do you stop desperate men eager to get their stuff ashore anywhere along the coastline?
There were measures to prevent this type of activity. The excise men, or preventative men as they were also called, operated often with the customs men, or in some cases even in competition with them, as they sought out nefarious activities. They did have access to the dragoons, mounted soldiers who were enlisted to assist with the seizure and capture of the smugglers, if possible in the very act of bringing the stuff ashore, which wasn't always easy, especially if they were outnumbered, as they most often were. The excise men also controlled the riding officers, who had a patch of coastline to monitor, anything from 4 to 10 miles, depending on the activity in the area. These posts were often filled by low-paid men who were getting on a bit in age and not really able to exert any pressure to stop the smugglers. They were the lookout men, and they had to keep their ears and eyes open. But they were easily bribed, intimidated, and often attacked.
I'm sure that there was many a time that the poor old preventative man would have looked out of his window in foul weather and thought, who's going to be unloading their cargo and contraband in conditions like this? So he probably went back and sat in front of the fire and had a nip of that lovely Napoleon brandy that the two stout gentlemen had left in a small keg by his back door. Only the other day,
the preventative men didn't have a chance. What they really needed, and what the government didn't provide, was a hell of a lot more men. And of course, we haven't mentioned the amount of corruption that was going on. I mean, it's one thing to bribe a night watchman guarding a warehouse, or make drunk a riding officer, or reward a small troop of dragoons with a few rolls of tobacco and a nice dollop of Assam. But it's quite another to put pressure on the magistrates to be lenient and to drop all charges on anyone up before the beak on smuggling-related offences. Many is the time a case was dismissed, though, through lack of evidence. A nice tub of something warming soon took care of that.
And those judges that wouldn't play ball found it very difficult to sleep at night when their house had been burnt down. And those that were still obstinate, well, they may not wake up at all, having accidentally or mysteriously drowned in one of the drainage ditches that crisscross the Romney Marshes. The message was clear. You don't cross the smugglers, especially not the Hawkers gang.
One of Rye's oldest buildings is the Mermaid Inn, and over the years it's played a significant role in the smuggling story. Judith, one of the current owners, told me about its comprehensive history.
The Mermaid was originally built in 1156. The cellars still exist from that time, which are directly underneath us here. They're Norman vaulted, and we've had them data carbon tested, so we know that's for real. Everything in Rye was burnt down in 1377, so we were rebuilt in 1420. Mermaid Street used to be called Middle Street, and it was a slum area of Rye where all the fishing fleet used to sort of live. So this would have been an ideal place for the smugglers to use.
So, would Judith tell me what was the connection between the infamous Hawkhurst gang and the Mermaid Inn?
The Hawkhurst gang at any one point could have 500 men at their side. They travelled a vast area of the south of England, but all the tales, when we first bought the Mermaid, in the library we've got all sorts of tales about the history. And it tells of the smugglers actually being very brazen, sitting in the bar, pistols on the table, talking. You know, they weren't at all frightened about what they did. They're quite proud of it.
The Mermaid Inn is riddled with secret passages and sneaky hidey holes. Judith was keen to show me round.
And this is the Elizabethan chamber.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's magnificent. I just love all the timber wherever you go. A big fireplace, which presumably would have been lit.
Yes, yes. Yeah, we've several like this, all with the French stone.
Now, you said many of the rooms have got secret passages.
Yep, nearly all the fire exits now are the old secret passages. So this one here.
Right. So you wouldn't know, and I mean, unless you put the sign there, you wouldn't know that
no,
that was
no.
a secret passage.
Because
it just looks
paneling.
Like a panel.
And this is a staircase which would lead down to the bar. So you see the way the stairs are worn?
Yes.
But obviously, you know, not for many hundreds of years. We have the customs office in Rye, which is just to the top of Mermaid Street, to the left. And obviously that's in very close proximity. And from one of the bedrooms upstairs, you had a very good sort of lookout window which looked right across the car park, and anyone could sort of left on guard could see if any of the customs officers came through. So then they could quickly go and hide things in the secret passages or secret areas as required.
And luckily, there are still hundreds of places like the Mermaid Inn all over Britain with similar stories to tell. The tide started to turn against the large gangs once they began to throw their weight around too much. One particular gruesome murder of a shoemaker and a customs officer in Hampshire by associated members of the Hawkhurst gang caused an outrage. William Galley and David Chater found themselves embroiled with a gang of murderous smugglers. To prevent them from squealing to the authorities, they were kidnapped and then whipped mercilessly to within an inch of their lives. Galley, almost dead from his vile treatment, was heartlessly buried alive in a shallow grave, while Chater was roughed up plenty more and brutally thrown down a dried well, and to be doubly sure, was stoned to death. The public were horrified, and the subsequent trial at Chichester caused a sensation. Smuggling started to get a bad name, but then there were more problems for the free traders to contend with, as war with France at the beginning of the 19th century started to look inevitable. This strange edifice is a Martello tower. It was built as a land defence against any invading force. Pitt's Pork Pies, they were nicknamed, after William Pitt had instigated them, and they were erected in a chain along the invasion coast. They were armed with soldiers and cannon. Well, this made it decidedly awkward for the smugglers to operate. And when Napoleon didn't come, these edifices made the perfect Coast Guard lookout towers and aided the preventative measures. The Martello Towers never saw any action, and they were soon deemed a great white elephant. There are a few remaining, and well worth a look if you're in the area, and they remind us of the invasion that never happened. But many men from the area had been conscripted into the Navy, and so, ironically, the local population relied more and more on their nefarious activities. But there was yet another obstacle to impede the smugglers.
For 28 miles, an additional nuisance was constructed for the free traders. It was called the Royal Military Canal, and it's still here.
It runs along the north of the Romney Marshes, from Seabrook in Kent to Cliff End in East Sussex. It was never designed as a canal for navigation as such, but as a giant ditch to obstruct any invading French force.
For the dead-of-the-night smuggler running his contraband, this was a ripe pig.
Imagine wading up to your neck in that cold water, desperate to get your goods across.
The death knell eventually came for the smugglers in the mid-1800s, when the government finally worked out the one measure they needed to do that would stop the illicit trade almost overnight. Ironically, it's what started the trade in the first place, and was ridiculously simple. They reduced the duty on imported goods to such a low rate that it was commercially not viable to bring in your luxury goods any other way. In other words, it was far cheaper to buy your tea legit.
It seems so obvious and really begs the question, why on earth did they wait so long to do it?
You know, I do wonder, perhaps wickedly, whether the high-up members of Parliament, those charged to govern this remarkable country of ours, really wanted it to stop. Or were they, perchance, benefiting individually from the occasional tub of rum, a keg of brandy, a packet of tea, or a roll of finest lace, or even a box of the world's greatest snuff? Who knows? I didn't manage to sell my tea. Turns out it's pretty worthless. Still, I suppose I can always go and have a brew. Well, until next time, goodbye.